So today we will be discussing about parser and its introduction to parser, then its top-down parser, then we will be covering bottom-up parser, then we will see relationship between parser, and at the end we will be covering some get questions also regarding all this topic which we will be discussing. So this is the table, this is the divisions of the parser. So there are two types of divisions from the parser. One is top-down parser, another is bottom-up parser. So what is parser? So parser is also known as syntax analyzer. That means the other name for parser. So for example, this is a diagram which we can see where G states about grammar and W is a string. So what is basically this showing? That the procedure of converting grammar to string is known as parser. So there is a grammar which will be given to us, and whenever we will be converting it to string, so the process or the procedure which we are covering is known as parser. So the next thing which we are covering is what is top-down parser. For that we need the figure. So this is our figure. So from here we can see parser, one side is top-down parser. So what is now top-down parser? We covered about parser. So there, here also we need what? Grammar. So here we already know that a grammar contains what? A start symbol. So whenever we generate string from symbol, then the process is known as top-down parser. So here we need another figure. So this is the start symbol. So whenever we move from start to a string, and that process is, that means we are moving from top to down. That's why it is known as top-down parser. Now the top-down parser has two types. One is recursive descent parser, one is LL1 parser. Now, what is non-recursive predictive parser? Now, if there is a string ABAB, then first L denotes from left to right, and second L denotes the derivation that is leftmost, and one means we will lead one by one output. So, our LL1 parser is also known as non-recursive predictive parser. So this first L means that the grammar will be moving from left to right, and the second L denotes that the derivation. That means we have two types of derivation. One is rightmost, another is leftmost. And this one means that we will be moving or leading one by one input.
So in bottom of parser, we will see this. So we know that grammar contains start symbol. The process of moving from any string to a start symbol is known as bottom-up parser. Bottom-up parser is also known as shift-reduce parser, where shift means push and reduce means pop. You can also see that LR parser has four divisions: LR0, SLR1, LALR1, and CLR1. Except operator precedence parser, no other parser will generate ambiguous grammar. Top-down parser are neither left recursive nor non-deterministic grammar. Suppose if there is a string ABAB, then the first A denote, then the first L denotes from left to right, and the R denotes the derivation, which is rightmost but in reverse order.
About the relationship between LL1, SLR1, LALR1, CALR1 and LR1. So for that we need a diagram. So this is the diagram which we will be seeing, and here we will see those parser which accept the unambiguous grammar. So already Ankit had discussed that the operator precedence parser can accept ambiguous grammar and may not accept, but these are the parsers with surety that it will not accept the unambiguous grammar. So here we can see that the most powerful parser is LR1. So this LR1 is the most powerful parser, which is also known as CLR1. This is the superset of all others. That means as it is the last one, so under it all are the subset of this LR1. Now, if any grammar is LR0, so if this LR0, if any grammar of this is LR0, then it will tell that it is SLR, it is LALR1, as well as it is LR1. Similarly, if any grammar is SLR, then can be LR0 or cannot be. That means we do not get a surety if any grammar is SLR. If any grammar is SLR, that we don't get any surety that it can be LR0 or it can't be. But if any grammar is LR0, we have a surety that it will be SLR, it will be LALR, it will be LR. So next, it states that if any grammar is LL1, that means this one, then surely it will be a LALR1. So the first question for this is, which of the following statement is true? That means we need all the relationship which we have discussed earlier. So here, SLR parser is more powerful than LALR, which are the first option A. Option B is LALR parser is more powerful than canonical LR parser. Option C is canonical LR parser is more powerful than LALR parser. Option D is the parsers SLR, canonical LR and LALR have the same power. So for the solution for this is, so it states that for solving this problem, we have to look for the Venn diagram of parsers. So now we have already discussed the relationship here before this. So we know that LR0, that means this one, is subset of SLR, SLR1, LALR1, is the subset of LALR, subset of CALR1. We will see a figure of this including also LALR1. Now we also have another relation. So what is that another relation? So it states, also remember one property, that is SLR is less than equal to LALR is less than CLR. Now checking for option A, SLR parser is more powerful than LALR. So this is a SLR, so is more powerful than LALR. So the option A was this. So now the question was that SLR, SLR parser is more powerful than LALR. So LALR is this one and SLR is this one. So it's not the correct option. From the above property, we can easily see that SLR is less than or equal to LALR, but not more powerful. Now, checking for option B, that is LALR parser is more powerful than canonical LR parser. So LALR is this and canonical LR is this. So both the SLR and LALR are less than CLR. So LALR cannot be more powerful than canonical LR. Checking for option C, canonical LR parser is more powerful than LALR parser. So it says CLR is this one and LALR is this one. So that means CLR is greater than both of them. So this from this above property, we can say that yes, CLR parser is more powerful than LALR parser. So when we check for the option B, that is our last option, it states that the parsers SLR, canonical LR and LALR have same power. So it is clearly not correct according to the above property. Therefore, we can state that only option C is correct, that is canonical LR parser is more powerful than LALR parser.
So this question says, which of the following kinds of derivation is used by LR parser? And the options are given rightmost, leftmost in reverse, rightmost in reverse and leftmost. So let's see how we can solve this problem. For solving this problem, we have to find that LR parser belongs in which of the top down, in which one top down parser or bottom up parser. We know that all the LR parser belong to the bottom up parsers. So in the bottom up parser, we make a tree from leaf to root, just like in the picture. We will also know that the bottom-up parser use rightmost derivation in reverse order. Therefore, option C is correct because every bottom-up parser uses reverse of rightmost derivation.
So here we have a question from Gate that it states that consider the grammar given below. That is, S tends to A, capital A and small a, then capital A moves to B, capital B and capital D, then capital B is either V or epsilon, and capital D is small d or epsilon. So here there is a given that let A, B, D and S be marked as follows. That means the number is given to each of them, or we can say indexes. For A it's 3, B is 2, D is 1 and S is 0. So it says compute the follow set of the non-terminal B and write the index values for the system in the follow set in the descending order. That means there is an example also given for that. If a follow set contains like A, B, D, S, then it should be 3, 2, 1, 0. Okay, so let's see how we can solve. So we have the index of A, B, D and S, which we can see here. And we have to calculate the follow of B, and the index value of the follow set will be in what? In decreasing order, or we can say in descending order. So when we have calculate the follow of any non-terminal, so here is the question which was given. So whenever we are solving the follow, so what happens here? We need to first check that the, as we have told, to check for follow of B, we need to check in the right side that B is containing or not. So we can see that B is there. That is being stated here that when we have calculate the follow of any non-terminal, then first we have to check if that non-terminal is present on right side or not. So here in our problem, we have the non-terminal on the right side, which we can clearly observe. So according to our problem, so this is the follow B. So we will move to what, that is the first of B. So we will calculate first of D. So a D contains either epsilon or small d. Now we need to note a thing. So whenever we take follow, we don't take epsilon. So we cannot put epsilon above because follow say doesn't contain epsilon. When we put, that means we will change this D to epsilon. So it is being stated the same thing, that epsilon in the place of D. Then the follow of B contains, that means whenever here we put epsilon, it will move to follow of A. So now we have to calculate follow of A. So as I have told that whenever we need to find follow of something, we need to first see that it is there in the right side or not. So as we can see, it is there in the right side of A. So we will know that that means this is first of A. That means this A will be also there with our follow of B, that is D, which was there, which we have find. So D comma A will be the answer. So we know that follow B is follow A, which means whatever we get in follow A, we will put that in follow B. So we got D and A. Now what was the value of D? That was 1. And what was the value of A? That was 3. Now as we have told, we need to answer it in decreasing. So A is indexing 3 and D is indexing is 1 from the table. Therefore, the final answer which we get is 3 and 1.
So consider the given grammar below. P goes to small x, capital Q, R, S. Capital Q goes to small x, z or z, capital R goes to w or epsilon, and capital S goes to y. What is the follow of Q? And here the four options are R, w, wy, and ws. To find the follow of any set, we need to see if that follow is present on the right side of production or not. So first is set gives all the terminal that begins in all string derived from A. Follow A gives set of all terminals that follow immediately to the right of A. So the Q is present in the right hand side of first production. Now follow Q is first of R, and first of R is W epsilon, which means first of R contains W and epsilon. we cannot put epsilon above because follow set does not contain epsilon. Replacing the epsilon in place of R, then we get follow of Q as first of R. Now we know that first of S. Now we know that first of S is Y. Therefore, the follow of Q contains W, Y. So the option C, that is follow Q is W, Y, is correct. Now another example is, consider the following grammar. Capital S goes to capital F and R. Capital R goes to asterisk, capital S or epsilon, F goes to ID. In the predictive parser table, M of the grammar, then entries M, S, ID and M, R and comma dollar respectively. The four options are given here. Now we need to make a format that belongs to the predictive parsing table. So here you can see the table. To fill up all the boxes, we first need to find all the non-terminals. So first S only contains ID. Therefore, first S is first F and first F is ID. Now first R contains asterisk and epsilon. First F contains ID. For production, R belongs to E. We will find follow of R. To find follow of any non-terminal, which we know that we have to check if that non-terminal is present on the right side of the production or not. So in our case, follow of R is present on the right side of first production. So here the follow of R contains follow of S. Now we know that the follow set of starting symbol contains dollar. Therefore, follow of S contains dollar, follow of R contains follow of S, that is dollar. Putting all the values in the boxes, we will get first S as ID, first R contains star, asterisk and epsilon, first F contains ID, follow S contains dollar, and follow R also contains dollar. Therefore, option A is the correct answer, that is S goes to FR and R goes to epsilon.
So here, another question which we have took from Reed, that is, it's consider the grammar by the following production rules with two operators, that is, one is asterisk and plus. Which of the following is true? It's being there. It's being stated, and these are all the production rules. So the first option is said that plus is left associative, while star is right associative. Second is plus is right associative, while star is left associative. C option is both of them is right associative. And D option states that both of them are left associative. So let's see what is the solution for this question. So to check the left and right associativity, we first have to draw a parse tree from the generated string of the given grammar. So let's see how we can do. Also, we need to check that the plus and asterisk are present on the production set or not. If they are present, then see the starting symbol. So here a star and plus is present in the right hand side. So now what we will do, we will see the starting symbol of that production. So if the starting symbol is on the right side, then it will be right associative, and if it's on the left side, then it will be left associative. So that is being stated here in this point 2. If it is present on the right side of the starting symbol, then it is called right associative. And if it is present on the left side of the starting symbol, then it is called left associative. Now, star is present in the first two production. So this is the first production which contains this star, and this is the second production which contains the star. Then, so S, P star P, here starting symbol is S, but the starting symbol is not occurring on the right side. That means we can see this S is a starting symbol, but in the right hand side there is any S. No, there is not any S, so this will not be considered. So we cannot find the associativity of star with this production rule. So now we will see for the second production rule, that is T, which is containing L or T star U. So the starting symbol here is T, and we can absolutely see that in the right side the T is containing, and we can see that this star, the starting symbol, is on the left hand side. So it means star is what? Star is left associated. So now we need to find for the plus. So for plus we have only one production rule which is there. So we will first see, is the starting symbol is there? So here it is P, the starting symbol. Yes, it's absolutely there in the right hand side. So now we will see this is a plus and the P is on the right hand side. So we can completely see that plus is right associated. So what we get the conclusion from here, that a plus will be right associated and a star is left associated. That means our option B, hence our option B is correct. So that's all for today.
Excellent presentation. Only just not for recording purpose, I must say, very good presentation also. And what I start, you give a brief history of this parsing. Start from the, I particularly like brute force parsing should be the first option. That is the recursive decent parser. But you should also maintain in your mentally that it is a brute force technique. In fact, brute force technique is it's called ambiguous grammar, unambiguous grammar. It will be great. But only problem is it cannot be ON. It may be ON square, ON cube, and space complexity is there. But it covers all. Then we go for, but brute force parsing is, you know, it can solve all the problems. But only thing, the time complexity, then came non-recursive, preemptive, that is LL1, but then you have to remove all your left recursion, because, but in you see that in our all expressions, left recursion is always there. If you remove those left recursion, the problem will be grammar looks too foreign to proper that LL1 parsing table should be unique entry. But the main disadvantage I found in LL1 is there cannot be any left recursion. So what is alternative then come? Shift reduce parser. Then shift reduce parser problem is when there is a confusion between shift and reduction and reduction and reduction, which rule to be used. Then we go for LR1. I think though they have written in the this function like shift reduce, LR0, SLR, LALR, LR1, I personally believe the first is shift reduce, then LR0. LR0 is like sort of Gandhari sort of thing. You put a blind and you just see the top of the stack and you maintain the top of the stack condition to what is the stack content. The next better option is LR1. Whenever you not only see the top of the stack, the condition, and also one look ahead of your input stream, and that it is really powerful, then it is the LR1 best option. The only problem is the parsing table, there are lots of entries, then the entries have to be collapsed into LLR and SLR. So my belief is the best option is you first learn shift reduce, then shift reduce, the problem is the stack, that is a Donald Knuth contribution, he's a great computer scientist. The shift reduce parser, instead of LR0, instead of actual symbol, we put the state information along with the symbol with the state information on top of it in pairs. In fact, everything happens on your state information, initially S0, and whenever it will be finished, the final S should be there, start symbol S0 S1, then when your it has been parsed. So that's great. That is LR1, but LR1 the parsing